I want to thank all of you for turning out this afternoon on this beautiful day in Morro Bay. I want to acknowledge my staff, Kevin, sitting in the back, and Annie, who I think is out at the check-in desk, both based here in San Luis Obispo County and available for any issues that we might be able to help you with. Today's focus, of course, is an introduction and update on the End of Life Option Act, which was signed into law last October by Governor Brown and became effective just a couple weeks ago in California. I'm going to lay out some of that background, but before I do, I want to acknowledge we're being joined this afternoon by Dr. Penny Borenstein, who is the director of the Health Department in San Luis Obispo County, and also joined by Erika Ruiz with the organization Compassion and Choices. And the way as our agenda sets forth, we're each going to share a little bit of an introduction of the history of the law, the elements of the law, and then we're going to open it up to your questions. And it's a little more formal than we normally do our town halls, but we do have the benefit of recording team here from Sacramento. I want to thank them for making the trip down, and by filming this today, we will have the opportunity to share it with other constituents who weren't able to join us this afternoon. When we do move into our Q&A, and we'll have ample time for questions and answers, if you're comfortable introducing yourself, we'd appreciate that and direct a question or a comment. You can direct it to any one of the three of us, or if it's a comment. And we just ask that you be respectful of others who also may have questions or comments to make this afternoon. And again, the purpose of this forum is to provide information. This is not to debate the issues that led up to this bill becoming law, nor is it designed to be advocacy for any particular end-of-life path that somebody may choose. I think at the core of this law is respect for the autonomy of the patient and the absolute right of a physician to participate or not. What I'm going to do for the lead-in is just talk about the elements of the bill. Then I'll turn to Dr. Borenstein to offer from a physician perspective, perhaps, some of the specifics of forms and reporting and eligibility, and then followed by Erika, who will share some of the perspectives of Compassion and Choices and the information that they make available to the public. So with that, we'll get underway, and again, just thank you all for being here this afternoon and your display of interest in this important subject. So I started working on this legislation in January of last year, January of 2015, but actually started researching it a couple years earlier when a group called the Senior Legislature of California, which is a nonpartisan, nonprofit organization of seniors who meet in Sacramento when we're in recess in the fall, and they prioritize issues of importance, particularly to seniors in California. And in 2013, this was prioritized as the number one issue of importance to the California Senior Legislature. There had been a history in California of trying to establish an End-of-Life Option Act. That last effort was in 2006, 2007, and that bill did not make it out of the State Assembly, and at the time it was opposed by the California Medical Association. So fast forward to 2015, changing dynamics in terms of public opinion and the history of four states that have enacted an End-of-Life Option Act: Oregon, Washington, Montana, Vermont, and in the courts in New Mexico, but Oregon with about 20 years of experience. Much of our legislation was modeled on the Oregon law, but we adapted it to some of the unique dynamics of California. For example, our act has mandatory interpreter translation components if a patient is not a native English speaker. And I'll go into some of those details. But we reached out to groups that we knew had historically had concerns or opposition. We reached out to the California Medical Association, and we knew that there was division in the CMA, not a unified position of opposition. There were doctors who were supportive, doctors who opposed, and doctors who were neutral had concerns. So we spent a lot of time meeting with the California Medical Association, the California Hospital Association, and the California Disability Rights Organization, who had concerns that we shared of avoiding any prospect for coercion of somebody who might be compromised mentally or physically. And I think you'll find, as you read the law, it is the strongest of all the existing laws in the country and built on a strong foundation of protections for the patient, first and foremost, as well as for physicians. So I'm going to outline some of the basic elements. I won't take you through all of the wondrous path of the legislation. We encountered some cul-de-sacs. We met some amazing people. And I will say, just as some further foundation, I'd say for me, the strongest takeaway of this experience was meeting some people who devoted, in some cases, the last weeks of their lives to speak to legislators, to testify in committees, knowing that they would not be a beneficiary of this law, but wanting to make sure that others would have a choice that they didn't have as a resident of California. One who got a lot of media notoriety, Brittany Maynard, we worked closely with her husband, Dan Diaz, and her mother, who described her decision-making and move to Oregon to be able to take advantage of the law in Oregon. And I'll refer maybe to some of the others as I go along, but amazingly courageous people whose commitment was really to the next group of people suffering from terminal illness. So first and foremost, this law is designed for a very limited universe of people within a limited universe of people. So the first limited universe are people who have a terminal illness and a terminal diagnosis. Within that universe, a group of people for whom the option to consider as part of the continuum of end-of-life options, they want the autonomy to have the choice, if they qualify, to self-administer a life-ending prescription. Part of our bill requires a physician to explore with that patient hospice options, palliative care options, and what we talk about is the continuum of end-of-life options. What we've learned from Oregon is that since that enactment 20 years ago, there's been a larger participation in hospice care, and 90% of the people who have used the end-of-life option in Oregon were in hospice care at the time that they chose to end their life. Interestingly as well, just over 50% of those who have qualified in Oregon have used the prescription, but well over 40% haven't. And something that's hard to quantify is how people who qualify for that prescription, it brings a certain peace of mind knowing that if the suffering, if the pain becomes too great or can't be controlled through palliative care or hospice care, they have the control to end that suffering. And so in over 40% of the cases in Oregon, that it's an option that's not ultimately exercised. So briefly, and we will provide a website, the California Department of Public Health has posted the text of the law and all the reporting forms required for a patient seeking consideration and for a physician. And Dr. Borenstein will talk about some of that. But so the criteria for a patient to be considered is a terminal diagnosis, less than 6 months to live. And some have said, well, that's imprecise. We know people who get a terminal diagnosis and they live for 3 years after a 6 month. It's just a starting point for eligibility. What we know is that the strongest human instinct is to survive. Most patients have a very strong will to survive. So for those who seek this option, they are enduring great pain or they fear uncontrolled pain or suffering is the primary motivator for a patient to seek this. They would go to their treating physician, their primary physician, and check with him or her, starting with a form initiating that conversation. And in our law, that physician needs to explore with the patient their exploration of hospice, palliative care, other options. If they satisfy the first physician visit, then there has to be a 15-day waiting period and a second consultation with a consulting physician who cannot be associated in practice with that primary physician. The consulting physician goes through a similar interview. Both interviews with the patient are private. So the patient might be accompanied by a family member, a conservator, a neighbor. They can come to the visit with them. They can provide transportation. But the consultation with the physician will be private. It's another safeguard for the physician to determine if there's any evidence of coercion. They're also determining any signs of a lack of decision-making capacity. We talked about decision-making capacity with the CMA. They say every physician, part of their evaluation of any patient, not just terminal patients, is they do a mental evaluation of every patient who comes in with a broken arm, a child who comes in with damage to the teeth. A trained physician is looking at the whole patient. If either of these two physicians has any doubt about the patient's decision-making capacity, they, by our law, have to refer that person to a mental health professional. And until there's clearance from that mental health professional, the process cannot move forward. Assuming the patient has decision-making capacity, the doctors agree in the terminal diagnosis and the will and capacity of the patient. At that point, a prescription can be written. It's usually not filled by the patient until they're at a point in their illness where they decide they do want to still move forward and have access to the prescription. They still have to sign a final attestation 48 hours within 48 hours prior to the self-administration of the prescription. In Oregon, it's most commonly been a use of a secanol barbiturate that's mixed in liquid and ingested orally in a liquid, and it's usually preceded by an anti-nausea prescription as well. In Brittany Maynard's circumstance, her mother and husband described her doctor said she would have increasing convulsions, lose control of her bodily functions, lose the ability to communicate. She suffered from terminal brain cancer. She'd been through surgeries, chemo, radiation. All of the traditional cancer therapies had proved ineffective. She and her husband decided to move to Oregon. She told her mother and her husband and her family she wanted to control the time of her transition on her terms, and she did not want to decompose to a person who could not communicate, who could not control bodily functions. So on November 1st of 2014, Brittany Maynard with her family at her side, holding hands, self-ingested the prescription and went to sleep and expired about 20 minutes after she ingested it. Her husband describes the family saying their goodbyes, expressing their love for each other, holding hands, laughing, crying, and Brittany going to sleep. And they carry the memory of that gathering with her at her bedside. We also met Jennifer Glass, a writer, a journalist from San Mateo County, who at age 52 had been diagnosed with lung cancer. It metastasized to her brain. She testified in our hearings. She did not move out of California. She had palliative care. She was put into a coma through sedation, and her sister was at her side and her husband. She came out of the sedation, complained of feeling as though she was drowning in her own body fluids, was in great disoriented and suffering. They increased the medication she was under. And a second time, she complained of drowning and asking for help. So her husband and sister carry that memory of Jennifer Glass's death. And I just contrast those two. These were both women who are committed to trying to establish this right. Brittany Maynard was able to exercise the right. Jennifer Glass was not. I think I've laid out the main elements of the bill. If a patient does use the prescription, the prescribing physician has to file a report that Dr. Borenstein will talk about. The Department of Public Health will keep track of all prescriptions issued and the postmortem report of the physician. The cause of death will be the underlying terminal illness. And a couple of legal protections that are important to mention. No life insurance company or medical insurance company can deny coverage or condition coverage on whether a person uses this or doesn't. So in other words, a life insurance policy that is not valid if a person commits suicide, if a person exercises their right under this law, that life insurance policy is valid and has to be honored. Nobody can be denied medical coverage. Some have asked, does your medical insurance have to pay for the prescription? They're not mandated by this law. They might or they might not. And it would be something a patient would have to determine based on the type of medical insurance they have. In Oregon, a half to two-thirds of insurance carriers there do cover the cost of both the doctor engagement and the prescription. So those legal protections are important. It's also a felony if anyone is found to have coerced a person to pursue this prescription against their will. And an area that's been troubling to people but was not an objective of this legislation, although a patient population I'm keenly familiar with, people suffering from Alzheimer's, dementia, are not eligible under this law because they cannot satisfy the decision-making capacity component. And we've received inputs from family members who think that's a shortcoming, people saying, if I suffer from dementia or Alzheimer's, I'd like to be able to use a directive, an advanced medical directive that would allow my family to pursue this remedy. That's not in this law. It's not in any law in the United States at this time. So while we're keenly aware of the suffering brought on by Alzheimer's and dementia, the narrow requirements of this law would not cover people suffering from that. I'm just going to close by acknowledging another amazing champion in our work, and it was a woman named Christy O'Donnell. She was a former LA police officer, a sergeant in the LAPD, a Republican, a single mother, who went to Knight Law School, became a lawyer, left the police department, and was representing people with disabilities. She was reading in bed one evening, and the page was blurring, and she went to her eye doctor thinking she needed to change her prescription. The doctor referred her to a neurologist who diagnosed brain cancer. She also went through a rigorous course of treatment that proved unsuccessful, and spent her last months of life traveling from Los Angeles to Sacramento to meet with legislators, to testify in front of committees. She was fully committed to the passage of this law. And when it went on the floor in the assembly for a vote, she had texted me and said, I'm so sorry I can't be there today. I can't travel anymore. She said, there must be something I can do. I feel helpless. And I texted, I said, you've done an amazing amount already. We're cautiously optimistic. We weren't sure we had the votes. And she said, well, I just feel like I need to do something. And I said, well, there is an assembly member in LA who's not in our yes column. And legislators had differing views on this, different moral beliefs, different religious beliefs that we respected. This legislator was concerned about protections for poor people. And I said, we have 24 hours until the vote. Maybe you could phone his office. He's also in the Los Angeles area. Next day we go on the floor in the assembly. There's passionate debate, and this legislator stands up and starts raising all of his concerns. And then he says, but I'm going to vote for it today because I don't think anybody should be denied the right to consider this option if they want to. And we were pleased, obviously, at this clarification of his position. We wanted to get in the high 30s. We needed 41 votes. We wanted to get in the high 30s to show that it was viable. We could go move two or three more votes. The first vote went up 42 votes, and then two more added on. We had 44 votes, including this legislator from LA. I texted Christy O'Donnell. I said, we got it, we got it. She texted back. She said, I know, I'm watching the Cal Channel. I'm here. There's tears running down my face. And I texted back and I said, and how did you get the vote of this legislator from LA? And she said, well, I'm not sure, but I understand 400 uniformed LA police officers phoned his office in the last 24 hours. So I think that was evidence of the brotherhood, the sisterhood of people in blue. They perhaps weren't very familiar with the law, but they knew it was important to a fellow officer. So there's many stories like that, but I think it's important to humanize this effort as well. And with that, I am going to turn to Dr. Borenstein, followed by Erika Ruiz, and then we'll open to your questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Monning, for being such a champion of this bill. I don't know how many of you know your senator really was the force behind this coming into being. And for that, again, regardless of what your personal opinion is and whether you would ever even consider using it, it is called the End of Life Option Act. And so it is just one more piece of the puzzle or the continuum of options that patients can take advantage of in their personal decision making around their end of life options. So, you know, certainly there's a lot of issues that go into that decision, philosophy, religion, values, et cetera, but it adds one tool to the toolbox. So I'm actually going to spend much of my time talking about all the upstream options, if you will, if you think of this as a continuum, with this being the last possible option that anyone really wants to be in a position to take advantage of. When I think about, you know, what are the options for someone who is in a situation of being told that they have a terminal illness, irreversible terminal illness, and we each, you know, would come to different thoughts about what that is. And I think there are five real practical things that have to be looked at relative to what one would want. First and foremost, always quality versus quantity of life. And I think you heard some examples of that, and I'm sure anyone who spent any time thinking about this is, there are always going to be situations where more life is a choice that a person takes, even if they are in severe pain, if they are feeling terrible, if they have a college student who's overseas who can't get back for another month, and that is the most important thing to that family for that reunion to happen, someone, you know, may choose that month worth of, okay, give me whatever it takes to keep me here, to hold my child's hand, that may be an option. So it's not always clear that if someone has an irreversible condition and is suffering, that the option is only to end life or to even stop treatment. So in this continuum, so first of all, sort of thinking about knowing what you want, and then some really hard decisions about what that will look like. So stopping treatment, not ending your life, but just at what point does one make the decision about stopping all treatment, be it chemotherapy, radiation, more pokes in the arm for lab tests to see how anemic you are, you know, that's one decision that needs to be made. When is the time that the person is ready to come to that first and very, very important decision? Secondly is feeding, nutrition, food, hydration. That's a closer in step. Is it time to consider that I'm going to forego any artificial nutrition or even hydration? And there's a sense, I think, that people think you float off into the night when that happens, and you know, it may take a couple of days. I always learned in med school that a human being can't live without hydration for 3 days, 72 hours. And then I watched my father-in-law have nothing for 7.5 days. And I thought, well, yeah, they don't always teach you everything right in med school. But I think people need to be aware that, you know, it's not necessarily the panacea. On the other hand, artificial feeding is tied to many known side effects and discomfort, swelling, pneumonia, what have you. So feeding decisions. And I know these are lovely things to talk about on a beautiful day in Morro Bay, but you know, they have to be spoken of when you get into thinking about this. And the third decision point, or third or fourth, is resuscitation. Under what conditions do I feel ready to sign a piece of paper or to have my physician put something in my medical chart and make it available on my refrigerator and whatnot that says, I do not want any heroic care, any resuscitation efforts, be it breathing, be it shocked, chest compressions, medications. So that's another important decision in the continuum to be made. And then finally, is a more active decision, is the end of life option, to say, I'm going to precede all these other things and decide when the time is right and actively do something to end my life. So there's the when, as I sort of described, getting to a point of deciding, and then there's the how, which I will talk about in our county, what those options look like for end-of-life care. And the where is the third most important consideration, and I will also talk about that. Regardless of what forms one fills out, it is important to have these conversations with yourself, with your family members, and even if you never sign a form, the most important thing anyone can take away from today is if you want to have any say in your end-of-life choices, at a minimum, have a conversation with one or more, two, three, four people close in your life who can fully understand your wishes and be able to articulate them if you are subsequently in a situation where you cannot articulate it for yourself. Now, having said that, of course, there are papers, and we live in a very legalistic society, so it is much better to articulate those wishes in writing. And so I'm just going to go over a little bit of the nomenclature. I'm sure that there are people who don't know the difference between a living will and an advanced directive and a power of attorney and a pulsed. So, hopefully I can help walk you through all of those different elements of these difficult decisions. So first, an advanced directive is a written statement of what you would want. It can be scribbled on a piece of paper. It can be gotten off the, you know, you can Google and find any number of versions. The state has a version. California's is fine. If you don't like it, you can scratch through things. You can, just make it as clear as you can as to what you'd like to have in with respect to some of these things I was talking about. Feeding, medication, resuscitation, et cetera. treatment. So the advance directive can be part of a living will, which is the expression of a person's specific preferences for medical care, or it can be part of a durable power of attorney, where you cede the authority to someone else to come forward with your wishes at a point in time when you yourself are not able to. Or both is actually the best, because you don't know what the circumstances are going to be. The last sort of form related to that, which is a very particular one in California, is called PULST. And this is for physicians to sign. So all the other stuff you can do either on your own, with a witness signature, with a lawyer, with your spouse who keeps it, and they all have a level of validity in our legal system. But even more important is, or equally important, I should say, is to have this document, which is called it's PULSED Physician Orders for Life-Sustaining Treatment. And the importance of this, and it's on a nice piece of pink paper, is so that it's identifiable by others who, you know, should someone be home alone, should there be no family available, it is meant to be in your medical record at your individual physician's office. If you get admitted to a hospital, that they put it in the medical record there, and somewhere visible in the home, so that when emergency medical services may arrive, that they understand that they have the legal authority to administer or not administer care per the wishes of the patient. So it's really a physician-directed order, but based on communication between the individual and the physician. So that's, yes, there are some on the back table, and I have a bunch here as well. It's two-sided, and it's available to you, and certainly we can take questions. I did want to talk about what are the options in SLO County. So there's another whole alphabet soup related to end-of-life care. We have in this county four hospice organizations. And medical hospice is one type, and volunteer hospice is another. And the difference between those two is the medical hospice falls under certain legal requirements that it can only take care of people who have made the decision that they are no longer seeking treatment for their condition, and it has to be within the projected last 6 months of life. The three that exist in our county are Dignity Health, Wilshire, which many of you may know formally as Hospice Partners of the Central Coast, and the third is Central Coast Hospice, which was an organization that broke off from Wilshire, and so now there are three medical hospices. What they provide quite a number of services. They can provide counseling, they can provide support, psychological support. They also provide the nursing and the medication comfort care. So again, not treatment, but care that provides comfort to the individual in their last 6 months of life. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, the volunteer hospice can provide services and more extensive services. They can provide psychological counseling, yoga, grief counseling for family members, activities, a whole host of things, and there's no restriction on when one can enter that program. It is completely free of charge. It is volunteer based, and it is called Hospice of SLO County. It's in SLO, but they will go to other places and provide quite an extensive array of services for people. anywhere from diagnosis where a physician may say you have 2-3 years is our best guess of how this is going to play out, to up until the last moments. So slightly different models. Then there's also palliative care, which you heard mentioned, which is the actual medications and other types of support to achieve the least painful and least oppressive and ill feeling that can be achieved with medications that are not meant to treat the underlying condition, but to treat the symptoms of the condition. So with respect to palliative care, Twin Cities Hospital has an actual unit in the hospital in Templeton. And the other place that has the opportunity to provide that center-based palliative care is Mission View Health Center here in San Luis Obispo City. That's slight difference between palliative care and comfort care is that you can provide, for instance, radiation to shrink a tumor is palliative care. It is different than not providing any treatment aimed at the condition, but the alternative would be providing pain management. So just to clarify the difference between comfort care and palliative care. Comfort care does not mean completely hands-off. So if someone's legs are swelling, you can have compression socks. That's not treatment for the condition. You can, if someone is having trouble dealing with secretions, they can get suctioning. That all of that is part of comfort care, but it's a little distinct from palliative care, where it's really aimed, it can be aimed at the condition itself as well to reduce the ill effects of the condition. Pain management is the last option that's available that an individual on an outpatient basis can just seek pain management without all the other wraparound services, and we do have several pain specialists in our county. To just give you a sense in our county of how this works now, what, you know, happens, the vast majority of people have their hospice care in their own home, or a significant number of them get hospice care in long-term care facilities. We do not have a center-based hospice program like many of our surrounding counties do, where you move into a place where the intention is to spend your last days. So our hospice care, people can go in and out of hospice being enrolled in the program, but the actual services come into your place of living rather than you going to a different living situation. And so to finally, end of life being the final step on this continuum, how does that come about? If you've made the decision that none of these other situations, or actually I misspeak. So you can be simultaneously involved in hospice, in palliative care, in any of the services related to end of life, but take advantage of the option to decide at any point in this continuum may be the right moment in time to use it, or just have it as security, as Senator Monning has spoken about. So the process of doing that, and I do have all the forms if anyone wants to look at them. I did not make copies. I hope that we don't have someone in this room in need of them at the moment, but certainly I have a website for where one can get all of this information. It's a very lengthy URL, if you will, so I will leave it available. But the process that you heard spoken of is the first communication with the physician, your personal physician, that has to happen on a couple of occasions. Then the consultant physician, mental health care provider as needed. And then if all of those pieces come together, the attending physician must fill out a checklist and compliance form that they have gone through all of the procedures that are required under this law and attest to determining that the patient has a terminal illness, that they're a resident of our state, that they have the capacity to make the decision, it's entirely voluntary, and that they have been fully informed of medical diagnosis, prognosis, and are requesting the service. And then there's additional requirements on what the patient needs to be counseled on. So things like make sure that you keep your drug in a safe place. Make sure somebody else knows that you have made this decision. Do not ingest your drug in a public place. Notify your next of kin when you may use this. Participating in a hospice program, palliative care is recommended. And there's quite a few other things, but I wanted to mention those in particular. And then the physician, after they provide the care, as you heard, has to complete a form as to utilization of the prescription. The patient has the obligation to also put in writing that they have been counseled, that they have made this decision willingly, that they have discussed it with family members or do not have family members with whom to confer on the decision. They need to have the two witnesses. And then, as you heard, again, the final attestation prior to making that decision that I am going to go forward and actually utilize the prescription that I could have taken advantage of, you know, months earlier, but now I'm ready to actually take action. And so there is a final attestation that I am moving forward with this. The one last form that pertains to the End of Option Act, the one exception to Senator Monning's statement, absolutely true that the physician and the patient are the only ones to have the conversation, and it's a one-on-one, except if there needs to be a language interpreter. And so the interpreter also, in such a case, would have to sign an attestation that they were party to it. And it cannot be, yes, thank you. So with that, I will turn it over to Erika.
Great, and just before Erika, I want to thank Dr. Borenstein. I didn't give Dr. Borenstein a very thorough introduction, and I do just want to acknowledge, I did identify her as the health officer for San Luis Obispo County, but in that role, she's also been a public health officer and advocate and known statewide for her advocacy for health promotion and prevention as the best tool in our health toolbox. So I just want to acknowledge your leadership here and statewide, and thank you for your participation today. And as we turn to Erika, I also just want to acknowledge Erika is the Central Coast Outreach Manager for Compassion and Choices. And Compassion and Choices, as Erika will describe, is a non-governmental, nonprofit organization that has been active nationally, providing information for people, and they've also been instrumental in advocacy in different states, including California. And as we worked in the legislative process, Compassion and Choices was very active in local communities in engaging legislators, constituents and legislators in throughout the state of California. And it was really a team effort, and I just want to publicly acknowledge the important critical role played by Compassion and Choices, and I know there's several advocates here in San Luis Obispo County as well. So with that, I want to thank Erika Ruiz for joining us today and for the work of Compassion and Choices. Thank you.
First off, thank you, Senator Monning. Without you and the other senators and assembly members who supported this bill, it would not be a reality as quickly as it was. So I do want to give some background to everybody about Compassion and Choices and about the medical aid in dying law that has existed in Oregon for 19 years. Compassion and Choices is the nation's largest, oldest, most active nonprofit organization committed to improving care and expanding choice at the end of life. And in Oregon, where the law has been in place for 19 years, what we found is that initially, many people and their medical providers were confused about the law. And heartbreakingly, we're waiting too late to start these decision-making processes with their doctors and their loved ones. And so despite the pain and suffering they were in, and despite the eligibility, they were not able to access aid in dying. And so because people lack accurate information about the law and how long the process generally takes, Compassion and Choices has launched the Access Campaign in California, which is a bilingual access campaign. And you might ask, what is the Access Campaign? It is all about educating the public, educating medical professionals, and ensuring that everyone has the information necessary to make the end-of-life care options for themselves. So I'll give you some information. We do have a bilingual hotline, so if you do want to write this down, the phone number to that is 1-800-893-4548. And we have a website, which is endoflifeoption.org. Both of those provide bilingual resources that educate you about all your end-of-life options, including hospice care, palliative care, and medical aid in dying. And we also have a doc-to-doc consultation line, so physicians can call doctors with many years of experience in end-of-life care and get answers to questions about medical aid in dying or get any questions about palliative care that they may have. That phone number is 1-800-247-7421. So our main goal here is to ensure that Californians have access to medical aid in dying and understand that it's a legitimate and accessible option for themselves. And in Oregon, Senator Monning mentioned this earlier, that the Death with Dignity Act there has resulted in more open conversations between terminally ill people and their families and their doctors about the end-of-life care options that they wish to have. And it's also improved palliative care training of physicians, and it's reduced barriers to hospice care. So it's really done a lot more than just provide medical aid in dying to people. And based on the history in other authorized states, we expect that in California, about 34,000 terminally ill people will seek out information from their doctors about the End of Life Option Act, and up to 1,500 prescriptions will be written a year. So it's very important that Californians understand this and have all the information that they need. And so in order to ensure this, we've given over 400 presentations since October when the bill was signed, and we have over 20 action teams throughout the state educating their communities about their end-of-life care options. And actually with me today is the San Luis Obispo team and one of the members from Santa Cruz, yeah. So if anyone has any questions for us afterwards, maybe wants to set up a presentation to an organization you belong to, you're welcome to see any of us. I do wanna share a story of the importance of the Access Campaign, an example from Oregon about a woman we will call Alice. Alice belonged to a primary care clinic with over 100 doctors, and she inquired about medical aid in dying, but was told that, unfortunately, no doctor at her clinic could help her. And so she contacted Compassion and Choices to see maybe what her options could be, and our Access Campaign paired her with a team of volunteer advocates, and with them, using her precious time, keeping in mind she's terminally ill, She was using her precious time fighting for her opportunity for medical aid in dying and was able to change the clinic's policy. And so this clinic of over 100 doctors changed its policy by listening to their own patient. And so it's just to say how important it is that if you seek out this option and you're told, you know, unfortunately here it's not an option, you don't have to take no as an answer. You can definitely reach out and see what resources there are and see if maybe there's another option. And that's what the Access Campaign is all about. It's educating what your options are and helping you work with your own doctors and within your own healthcare system to see what else would be an option if the policy could be changed. So it's important to talk to your doctor now. What we advocate is that people talk to their doctors and their loved ones as early as possible about their end-of-life care wishes. And that includes whether or not you want medical aid in dying. It might just be that you want hospice at the end of life. You just want to talk these things through. You don't want to wait until you're terminally ill to start these conversations. You know, the very importance of having an advanced health care directive and really open conversations is that at the meat of it, that you really need to start talking to people about what it is you want and learning about what the options are as well. And so I just want to thank everybody for your interest in learning about the End of Life Option Act. And once again, the San Luis Obispo team and myself will be here afterwards in case you have any questions about setting up a presentation or questions about resources available. Thanks.
Thank you, Erika. And we will open up to your questions. Again, if you could identify yourself if you're willing to, and questions directed to any one of us or commentaries are okay as well. I want to just offer two reminders. You cannot use an advanced directive to express that you want an end-of-life option. You can use an advanced directive for the reasons Dr. Borenstein mentioned, but the end-of-life option is only in real time after diagnosis of a terminal illness in direct conversation with your physician. And the other historical backdrop I failed to mention, Dr. Borenstein referred to the do not resuscitate orders. California was the first state during Governor Brown's first term in office to establish a do not resuscitate right of a patient. And what that really underscored, it was the first state, and now all 50 states respect that right. It put the power in the hands of the patient. And some doctors said, well, I'm trained to prolong life and I could never participate in this because my Hippocratic oath says I have to protract life. Well, with the do not resuscitate orders, we've recognized that power lies with the patient to decide, and the patient can direct the physician to follow their wishes. Other thing to underscore, the End of Life Option Act, absolutely voluntary for a physician. And so somebody may have a physician who chooses not to participate, and that's why it's important to have the conversation. And some medical institutions, including virtually all Catholic medical institutions, have the right under the law to opt out. And even a physician that works for them who may want to participate can't do it under the umbrella of that institution, but could potentially do it in their own private practice outside of that institution that has opted out. So with those clarifications, you've been patient listening to us. The floor is open if you want to raise your hand. Do we have microphones? We have a floor microphone here. So as people are able to queue up to the microphone, that way we'll capture it for the recording. If you're not able, you can raise your hand from your seat. There's got to be some questions or comments. Yes, please come forward. Thank you.
I'm Carolyn Atkinson, and I'm from Los Osos. Can you touch? Some places you can, some you can't. I have several questions, and so I'll just ask them, and then one of them is, part of the costs that I read that included in the setting up of it was a aid in dying database, and I wonder what that would be and what it would be for. And the other question is if, I know there's hospitals that opt out of other procedures, but now they're getting sued. So what protection do doctors have of not getting sued? And is it gonna be monitored by area statistically on, and by doctor and hospital on who's prescribing this? And that those are my questions.
Thank you. I'll take a first stab here. The law does require the Department of Public Health to establish and maintain a database, but it's to record the confidential reporting from physicians. In other words, it will protect the HIPAA protection. It will not identify a patient by name, but it will be that final report filed by a physician that will indicate the underlying terminal illness and circumstances and whether or not the patient utilized the end-of-life prescription. So that database will be maintained and available for public review. And at the end of each year, the Department of Public Health will aggregate that information that I think goes to your third question. That can be broken down by zip code, by the doctor reporting includes certain demographic information about the patient. So that database is patterned again after the one maintained in Oregon, but again for California, we're expanding some of the metrics. And then with the question about a hospital or a physician opting out and potential liability, part of our negotiations with the California Medical Association, there are very strong immunity provisions that protect both physicians and medical institutions, protections both for those who opt out and protections for those who participate. And those you can see again, if you Google California Department of Public Health, we have the URL, but I think if you just Google California Department of Public Health, their website, you can go to the actual language in the law and you'll see all those immunity provisions as well as penalty provisions. Do you want to add?
Yeah, if I could just add a little bit of, so I think the statistics that you heard from Erika about the percent of people who got a prescription and used it or didn't use it, or I'm not sure, maybe both of you had said that, that comes from Oregon's database over many years. And so that's California's database is designed to answer questions from those who have concerns, ongoing concerns about what is, you know, the nature of the people who are going to use this and how many of them compared to those who think of using it actually do. So some of the demographics that are inherent are, you know, the nature of the condition, whether there was any kind of disabling condition, race, income, age, area, in order to answer those questions in a prospective fashion about whether or not the law appears to be being disproportionately used by any sector of the population.
Sir. Thank you for indulging the microphone, but.
I come from 15 years in pharmaceutical industry, GlaxoSmithKline, Pfizer Pharmacia, and Roche Diagnostics, AccuCheck. I like the fact that the idea is coming to California from Oregon, but funding could be an issue. Have you been looking into private pharmaceutical industry? Are they giving free medications? And we used to do a lot of presentations like this and help out. So I'm actually taking care of my mom and dad in Avila, and so this is wonderful news, and thank you for this. But really, private funding in pharma, are you guys utilizing those funds?
Thank you. First, thank you for your work, and wish you the best with your family situation. So one of the challenges we've encountered is the prescription I mentioned of Seconal that has been the preferred prescription in Oregon. Since the law passed in California, and I don't know if this is causal or coincidental, there's one manufacturer now based in Quebec in Canada, Valiant Pharmaceutical. The cost has gone from about $1,500 $5 for a prescription, which that's high, to $3,000. So if you're among a group of people whose medical insurance doesn't cover it, this could be prohibitive. Valiant's gotten some strong public feedback, but they're not bound to lower their prices. We do know in reaction to this, physicians and pharmacists in both Washington and Oregon have worked with other formularies, other combinations that are dramatically less expensive, $500 to $600, and I fully expect California pharmacists and physicians will be exploring that as well. And I think part of your question was also, pharma as a network has some charitable provision, and I'm not familiar. I don't know, Erika, do you know if they've offered any charitable contribution of prescriptions?
At this point, there hasn't been any charities set up for that. I know in Oregon it was an option, I think just because not as many people would be accessing it there, but we've got so much bigger of a population that I haven't seen anything set up. But I will add some health plans that have come out and said that they will go ahead and cover both the doctor visits and the medication. Anthem, Blue Cross, Blue Shield, Kaiser, Sutter, and Medi-Cal. And Medi-Cal will be using California state funds for that. They've budgeted for it, so it won't come from federal government because the federal plans won't cover it.
Thank you. We did hear along the way concerns about safety and prescription materials in a medicine box at home. My understanding in Oregon, the way the prescription is distributed is in capsules, multiple capsules that have to be disassembled and the powder poured into the liquid and then stirred and ingested. There's not a single capsule that could fall into the hands of a child. It would require a lot of dexterity and a lot of intent. Also, people pointed out there are many more lethal painkillers and other opioids in medicine kits that aren't, we don't have public requirements of how they are stored or kept locked or anything like that. So again, the turnaround time, excuse the expression, but in the experience in Oregon, most people who qualify for the prescription wait to fill it until they're within days of considering self-ingestion. And then we do have some provisions in the law for recovery, return to the pharmacist who issued of an unused prescription. If the person dies without reliance on the prescription, it can be returned to the pharmacist. And the voluntary provisions for physician, well, patient first, physician second, and pharmacist also, voluntary participation.
Hi. Thanks for everything and for being here today. I'm a volunteer in Santa Cruz with Compassion and Choices. I'm a physician, and we've had a lot of community groups and organizing events, and one thing that's come out is that the people on Medicare, most of the people that are elderly or over 65 are on Medicare. Medicare will not cover the med, and so all of our supplementals will not apply because the supplemental only applies to the 20% that Medicare won't cover. So cost is a huge issue. I was at a meeting last night and somebody from Final Exit came and she said, well, nitrogen is very effective and it costs next to nothing. So why can't you use nitrogen instead of a drug that's up to $4,500? And I think we're going to see a lot of creep out of the woodwork from people who have been involved in end of life using methods other than what's self-ingested, very expensive medication. I wonder what we're going to do about that and how we can get a cost that's acceptable.
Well, thank. Can you just identify yourself?
Oh, Susan Humanic, OBGYN from Santa Cruz.
Yes, thank you for being here today and for your work. So others may have thoughts on this. So before this law passed, there have been groups and individuals who have facilitated aid in dying, and it's been under the radar, and it's illegal in the state of California. The law that has been passed has very specific criteria that we've described. It does not say what the medication has to be. It does have the chain of prescribing from physician to pharmacist to patient. The Medicare challenge, I think we're going to see hopefully these other formularies that will reduce the cost and potentially some charitable nonprofit organizations that may step up to help people in need who don't have medical coverage that would cover it, or family means that would cover it.
Yeah, I'm just going to confirm the bill does not say anything about the specifics of the medication, so it is something that a physician decides with their own patient, what is appropriate for them, what makes sense for them, and keeping in mind possibly cost issues with that.
I'm Karen Kolbe. I'm a rheumatologist who practices in Santa Maria. Two questions. One is about the residency. Who's a resident? How do you become a resident? How long do you have to be here to be a resident? And my my second question is, I have gotten a couple of email, I'm going to call them solicitations, but email notices from like the CMA and also from the County Medical Society saying this exists, and how would you like to be on the list? And I'm going like, well, I don't know. I mean, I want to be aware of this. And if it sounds like there's a lot of reporting and educational things I would have to do should I choose to participate in this, and I'm certainly not opposed to that, but you know, I don't want to be on some kind of list where somebody's going to say, oh, your doctor won't do it, you know. I don't want to go into this, you know, as an avocation, you know.
Right.
So if you're aware of, again, for example, what the CMA is asking of us, or is it just a way to get more information to us? And one other question then is, what is considered that primary care physician? I mean, I practice specialty medicine, but I actually am probably the primary care physician for people with my disease. So.
Correct. Thank you. So let me take a shot at those, and my colleagues may want to add to it. Establishing residency is relatively easy, but it does require documentation. It can be a California driver's license, proof of paying utility bill, like a PG&E bill, etc. There's not a time frame, in other words, of 30 days or 60 days. It's showing proof of residency. And the bill describes different ways you can prove residency. I've mentioned a couple of them. I think the bill has some other ways that you can prove residency, but it's not like a one-year residency requirement.
So as fast as the DMV will turn you around?
Correct.
Okay.
Right, and that's where office might be able to help you if you have problems.
Okay.
I think half our calls are related to that. The CMA list. So I do know that the CMA has put out guidelines to physicians that are very specific. They include all the forms, and they include information to help a physician who wants to learn more and potentially participate. I'm not aware of a CMA list of participating physicians, but I may just not be aware of that. My wife is a practicing family practice mm-hmm. physician. The California Academy of Family Physicians has also done materials and webinars on end-of-life mm-hmm. option. I think one of the concerns of a public list of physicians is people facing potential discrimination or abuse being mm-hmm. publicly listed. It does not have to be it has to be your attending physician, so the physician you're seeing dealing with the terminal illness. So that may be a primary care physician, it may be a specialty physician, but it's defined, we define in the bill your attending physician, and that's a little more strict than the consulting physician. The attending physician might be your specialty cancer doctor, mm-hmm. and the consulting might be your family doctor. That mm-hmm. could be one gotcha. Possible formulation. Okay. Do you want to add to that?
Yeah, so I can add for the residency requirement that if you lease or own property in California, you can use that as proof. If you have tax returns, you can use that as proof as well as driver's license. And then as for the CMA list, as far as I know, there's no list of doctors, and on our website, the endoflifeoption.org, we do have a list of healthcare systems you can find by zip code, but there's not a list of physicians. So we definitely want to keep the privacy of those physicians, and we don't intend on ever listing physicians, just healthcare systems.
My residency questions were, you know, for someone moving here from another state, particularly, so.
Right, and yeah, go ahead.
Oh, I can add to the, because as a physician and a member of the Central Coast Medical Association, I also got the same request to let the medical association know if you are a physician who would be willing to apply the act. It is not meant for public distribution. It is meant as a resource if a patient were to try to get information through the medical association as to what alternatives may be if their provider has opted out.
Okay, great. Thank you.
I can comment on the Medical Association. My name is Dana Gobe, and I'm the Executive Director of the Central Coast Medical Association. And we have had numerous requests from medical and the community at large, hospital systems, health systems, of who is going to be the keeper of physicians that will offer this service. So it is something our medical association felt that we would be an appropriate community group to have such a list of physicians if the physician wanted to be on this list. As people have been saying, it will not be a public list, it will not be on our website, and our commentary to anyone seeking this option is to first speak with your primary care physician, your attending physician. So that is the directive, but we do want to have resources available if they are needed.
Thank you, Dana, and thank you for being here today. You know, just in addition to that, I think, as was said earlier, the number one takeaway from our gathering is to have the difficult conversation within your family and with your primary care physician. And this isn't limited to people with a terminal diagnosis. Most people, fortunately, will not have an end of life connected to a terminal illness. But raising with your physician at your annual checkup, you know, I'm just curious, I've been reading about this End of Life Option Act. Is that something that you're familiar with? Is that something you would provide support for somebody if I were to have a terminal illness? It's a fair question to ask, and some physicians are probably giving it a lot of thought. Others perhaps haven't had that question asked of them, but that conversation could prompt them to contact the CMA if they're a member, to look at those guidelines from the CMA to educate themselves. And then it also leads to the conversation of discussing other end-of-life preferences, making sure they have a copy of your POLST form that they've signed. I supported this law. Our co-author in the End of Life Act was Senator Lois Wolk. She carried legislation to establish the POLST form in California, and just last year we also passed legislation that it can be part of your electronic medical record. So again, most doctors and health facilities are converting to electronic medical records. If you have a pulsed form, ask them if they can make it part of your electronic medical record, because it may be in their file at your doctor's office, but you may end up in an emergency room after an accident in another city. With electronic medical records, they could retrieve that pulsed form in another city. That's the goal, to have it be communicated that way.
Okay.
Please go ahead.
I do want to add that if you talk to your physician about medical aid in dying and they haven't been educated on it and they have questions, you can reach out to Compassion and Choices. We do education for medical professionals, so we would be willing to go out and educate the medical staff.
And I just wanted to add that a recent change within the last year, I don't know exactly, Medicare will now pay for an end-of-life discussion as a medical visit. So that's an important change, and it's hard to do within a 12-minute doctor's visit for lancing, you know, your lesion, but the opportunity now exists to actually schedule an appointment, and the provider can be reimbursed.
Do we have time for a couple more questions? Do you want to come forward, please?
Hi, I'm Celine Souza. I've got a couple, maybe three questions, but the first two for any of the doctors who are here. What happens, does taking the second oral prescription always work? And if it doesn't, what are the consequences?
No, this is the, you know. I am not aware of a failed attempt. Seven? Okay.
I can add to that too. Part of the reform, the paperwork between patient and physician informs the patient of known potential side effects. Obviously, the primary side effect is death of ingestion, but it does also inform of potential mishaps. In Oregon, over 19 years, there have been some reported unsuccessful. A person has thrown up the medicine, and so it has not been effective. Now the protocol is to use a anti-nausea drug an hour before ingestion of the prescription.
I was just wondering if some people have been left with paralysis or strokes or in the condition that they didn't want to be in the first place after possibly not succeeding in taking it?
Not that I'm aware of.
Okay. And then the other question, I can see how this bill would save money for insurance companies in the long run. And I was wondering if, you know, because like maybe patients wouldn't receive what I would consider appropriate long-term care, but what would like the long-term savings?
Right, that's
be,
a
like,
great question.
For California, like, I mean, I'm hearing about the 20 teams. I don't know if that's all voluntary or if that's paid for by taxpayers. I'm just wondering, is there an expense or a loss to the state taxpayers?
So it's a great question. No medical insurance companies participated in the legislative debate as supporters or opponents. They stayed away, and I think rightfully so.
Just
since the law has passed, now you heard the listing of those that will cover both the counseling, the end-of-life support, and the prescription if that is the choice of the patient. In terms of a cost analysis, any insurance company that would seek to have you pursue that path and deny treatment would be subject to felony prosecution under our law. You can't deny available treatment and require the person, the only treatment available to use this End of Life Option Act. That said, there is a caveat that an insurance company under your current policy is not necessarily obligated to pay for untried therapies or remedies that may be experimental in nature, mm-hmm. that may be offered in another country but not the United States. So this law can't compel them to provide coverage for something that they normally don't provide coverage for in the way of a treatment.
Okay, thank you. And by the way, my dad was one of those who was put on hospice because he had 2 weeks to live, and he lived 3 years. So I know that it's kind of this terminal diagnosis business is it's
right.
No, just a guess.
No, and it's so, and again, I think the experience in Oregon, doctors do their best based on their experience with the disease, the course of the disease. With Brittany Maynard, it moved more rapidly. She thought she had 6 months, and she didn't have 6 months. The will to live is a very strong will, mm-hmm. and most people who are able to maintain any quality of life in terms of ability to communicate with loved ones and live pain-free, even though they may have qualified, and maybe that prognosis turned out, like with your father, to be inaccurate, mm-hmm. there's not evidence that people, when they hear the 6 month, they're qualifying for the prescription and immediately taking it. Right. They're gaining security by having that option as part of this continuum mm-hmm. of care. So,
well, thank you for having the forum.
Thank you for being here. And I think with that, maybe just some closing comments. I'm sorry, you go ahead. Well, this will be our last question. Okay. Thank you for your patience.
Sorry. I'm a retired psychiatrist. I went to medical school 50 years ago. They didn't teach us how to talk to patients, which I understand is Stanford. They have courses on how to talk to your patients now. There is a book called The Talk, which covers this whole thing by a man who spent his life in geriatric centers. So the text is available. There's also, I believe, the same options in Holland, and they have gone in a very dangerous direction because certain doctors over there feel that this is a route for treating severe depression, and they are prescribing this for severely depressed patients, not medically ill patients. So that's because of the belief system of a couple of doctors who are in the business of giving the medicine. They've been able to convince the lawmakers to change the law. This is terrible.
It is. It's
but obviously you have to be aware there are some people who get to that point. And my brother died in a hospice. That they knew he was going to die on Sunday. I got there on Saturday, and it was a very nice visit, and we didn't need that, fortunately. But who knows what's going to happen. I'm the last one in my generation to survive. So we'll see.
Well, thank you for being here and sharing that experience. I do know that with some of the hospice care and some of the sedation, there have been care providers who have consciously increased sedation to a level knowing that it's basically going to result in the death of the patient. And it's kind of the gray area that we've been practicing under. This law actually will provide care providers with legal protection, but again, with a primary protection being for the patient. The example of the Netherlands, I think it's important to point out, the Netherlands has actually legalized euthanasia, where the physician administers a life-ending drug. And there is no state in the United States that has legalized euthanasia, and nobody who's pursuing it that I'm aware of in the United States. Every state that's established an end-of-life option act, similar to California, it's been patient-directed and physician-facilitated under the criteria that we discussed. I can't agree with you more about the need for better training of end of life. There's an excellent book called Being Mortal by Atul Gawande, thank you. And in that book, he doesn't really take a position on what we've been talking about today, but he does illustrate through different patient stories and family stories how ill-equipped many members of the medical profession are to talk, to listen, and to facilitate a patient's wishes. So I highly recommend that. Also, Sanjay Gupta with CNN is doing a feature story on the California law. It was supposed to air a week ago, but then with the tragedy in Orlando, it's been postponed. I don't know when it will air, but he spent a week or 10 days in California talking with different people. He said he came to California, not certain if he is a, he's an oncological surgeon, whether or not he supported an end-of-life option. He said after meeting with some terminally ill patients in California who wanted it for themselves, it made him a believer that it should be a right of a patient's autonomy. Did you want to add any final comments?
Sure. The main thing I want people to take away from it, and Senator Monning already touched on this, is the importance of having these conversations with your doctors and your loved ones. Part of the bill is doctors do not have to tell you that this is an option. So you have to do your due diligence and ask about this and let your doctor know, I'm potentially interested in this. This may not be the route I want to take, but I want to check that you will honor my end of life wishes and just check with them. And also insurance companies won't tell you that they cover it. So you have to call and see if your insurance does cover this. And that's it. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Erika. And I think Dr. Borenstein might have a final comment.
I just want to say, I made that joke about, is there a real doctor? You know, doctors are fallible and quite diverse, and over generations have had different teaching and perspectives. Some doctors find it challenging that patients come with lots of knowledge in a way that they didn't used to, whether it's from seeing a television ad or Googling or what have you, but I think that is all good to empower the patient to ask the questions. So a doctor who says you have 6 months to live may not be right, as we heard. And so you can go in and out of hospice as the situation changes. Just because a doctor says this is what is going to happen does not mean it will. Similarly, if a doctor says this is the treatment you need to get well, you should also question how long is that treatment going to last, what's it going to do to me, and have those in-depth conversations. So I just want to say, you know, it is really all about communication and push to have the opportunity to have that communication with your physicians.
Thank you, Dr. Borenstein. And I'd just like to close by again thanking all of you for being here, our team from Sacramento who are capturing this for others to learn from, our San Luis Obispo staff and the Compassion and Choice volunteers and team who are here today. We didn't know where Governor Brown would come down when the legislation reached his desk. We had no clear indication other than that he had an open mind and would struggle with his decision. His signing statement is short but eloquent. I won't read it all. He does refer to Archbishop Desmond Tutu and others who he conversed with in reaching his decision. But his final paragraph, he says, I do not know what I would do if I were dying in prolonged and excruciating pain. I'm certain, however, that it would be a comfort to be able to consider the options afforded by this bill. And I wouldn't deny that right to others. Signed, Edmund G. Brown, Jr. So with that signing, the law has become effective in the state of California. I want to close by wishing you not a good death and transition, but a good life and a healthy life. So pursue good health. Thank you for being here today. And we'll be around for a few minutes afterwards if anyone wants to ask follow-up questions. Thank you.